The following production comes from the imagination of Matthew Allen, where the best song's not the single and the bonus tracks don't count. We gonna be cursing, y'all. Listener's discretion is advised.
This is what happens when an unstoppable force meets an immovable object.
There are times when you need someone, I will be by your side.
Good morning or evening, friends. It is your friendly announcer, Mr. Matthew Allen, the well-dressed headphone addict, coming at you live and in living color from Brooklyn, New York. And it is time for a brand new episode of Get Off the Fence, the premier music debate podcast where we do album versus album, at least for now. It is episode 4, Common, Like Water for Chocolate versus B. And we have a very special guest, Mr. J.R. Robinson.
Yo, peace. What's up to the people out there tuned in?
Yo, how you doing, my man? How's everything going?
Everything's great, man. Everything's great. Hit the ground running. New year. Some people like to call it a clean slate. I like to call it a continuation, you know, just
keep it moving.
Stay moving, stay focused, keep walking in your purpose.
I like that, man. I like that. Now, this is like a big like deal for me because I remember listening to Ben Williams' State of Art album and hearing a Lee Morgan story, and I'm like, yo, this dude is off the hook, this MC.
7/10/1938, Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, birth the prodigy. A brilliant musician in the making, pops played organ at the church every weekend. At an early age, he collected records, grew well-versed, so who was playing the best with horns and drums, using arms and lungs to take the world by storm and build a legacy, son.
And I'm like, and then I get to meet you and everything, and it's just like been a whirlwind since then, man.
Yeah, man.
Just, it's been so dope. So just let the people know all of the slashes and hyphens that comes with being J.R. Robinson.
Yeah, man. I mean, for the most part, yeah, peace to Ben Williams, you know, just fresh off this New York Jazz Festival, mm-hmm. Winter Jazz. So peace to Ben Williams. If you haven't heard the Lee Morgan story, go check that out. But yeah, my career really, long story short, starts here in New York City in the 90s. Stretch Armstrong and Bobbito Garcia had a record label called Fondulum. So in 1996, he released my group Scienz of Life. And pretty much from that point, plugged us into the international circuit. So I spent a lot of my career really nurturing relationships in places all throughout Europe, Japan, South Africa, Australia, and a lot of international spots, working with labels, etc. Still to this day, have run and worked with a lot of independent labels during my journey, and got to work with a lot of amazing artists, from everyone from MF Doom to Aloe Black to, Blue, to Lewis Parker out in London, and just, yeah, it's been a wonderful journey. If you're not hip to John Robinson, check me out on the johnrobinsonproject.com. And, definitely lots of music. Education is a part of the journey as well. And although it's been 20-plus years, I feel like I'm just getting started.
That's what's up, my man. That is what's up. Now, just real quick before we get into that, I have to acknowledge this is being recorded at the Media Center at Brick Arts Media Brooklyn. And you are affiliated with a show in my department. I want you to just to give a quick shout out.
Yeah, big shouts to Visual Caffeine, the whole VizCaf fam. You can check that out, VizCaf.com. And we're keeping the hip-hop alive and well by letting a lot of people based around the hip-hop and its culture tell their stories directly so that there's nothing misconstrued, you know, so we've been able to interview a lot of legendary people on down to emerging artists and creatives. So check us out, Visual Caffeine.
Yes, indeed. Shout out to Pedro and Sandy Soler.
Totally.
All right, so we're going to get right into it. We are talking about the excellent Chicago MC, Common Sense, Mr. Common, Mr. I'm One Award Away from an EGOT. Common has been a consistent force in hip-hop since the early 1990s. His self-aware and socially conscious lyrics gained him a following and respect amongst his peers until he elevated himself into a wider audience that's landed him film roles, Academy Awards, and a seat at the table of political commentary. But through it all, music has been his greatest love. And today, my guest and I are going to settle the score between which album is the best between two of his classics, 2000s like Water for Chocolate versus 2005's B. And we're going to start with category number one, bookends, as always, where we talk about the opening and closing tracks of the albums. Now, JR, you're my guest. You go first. Please yes. enlighten the public. What are, what's the opening track of Like Water for Chocolate?
The opening track is Time Traveling, mm-hmm. Like Water for Chocolate. We're talking about such a groundbreaking track for an opening, you know, and a lot of people may not agree, but this is why I say groundbreaking. We're at a time where, you know, Common before this time wasn't really known for a bunch of musicality on his albums. Mm. You know, it was more boom bap, sample and drums, scratches, straightforward hip hop. I feel like maybe on the album before it, he started to lean towards the musicality, bringing in singers, et cetera, et cetera. But this intro, you know, first off, it boasts Roy Hargrove, you know,
R.I.P.
Definitely. So Roy Hargrove's on the horn on the joint. It's a tribute to Fela Kuti.
Mm-hmm.
So that right there is just putting a lot of things in perspective for us at the time in 2000. You had, you know, a lot of parties and Afrobeat popping. And then he says, yo, tribute to Fela Kuti. I believe his son's also on that.
Yeah, I think Femi is on
Femi's
that one.
On that one. And yeah, it just musically, I felt like this was some of Calm's best work to date at that moment. You know, not to say he didn't do anything that I felt was comparable after, but I felt like when that hit, that was his best work in my heart and my mind. And I just felt like as an intro, it was pretty long, but the musicality of it just really held me in terms of just who was involved, how it was put together.
Now, when you say who was involved, let's delve down deep with that one. Who was involved with not just the track, but a large sense of the album? Who was involved on Time Traveling?
Time Traveling, what? Questlove.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, so you got Questlove from the Roots involved. You got Roy Hargrove involved. Of course, throughout the record and overseeing the production, you got J Dilla, the late great. Rest in peace to Dilla.
Absolutely.
And I'm trying to remember who else. Femi's on that.
Yeah, James Poyser.
James Poyser.
Who's also all over the record.
Absolutely. Yeah, all over the record. And then I believe that's it on that track. Is there a singer on there?
No, I don't think so.
No. Okay. So, yeah, I felt like that's what hit me about this record overall. I mean, we'll get into it more, but it was just the musicianship in terms of, or I should say the integration of musicians into the hip-hop music. And I feel like these are the type of albums that led up to, like, To Pimp a Butterfly.
Yeah.
And just that template of saying, I have these ideas, but I may not be able to reach all these ideas with just a drum machine in the studio or turntables. I need to bring some musicians in here. And I felt like at the time, he was bringing a lot of, you know, next-level musicians that people knew easily in their respective jazz worlds, but they didn't easily know them in the hip hop world, you know. And I felt like, yeah, he was just bringing in and ushering in that whole Soulquarian movement as well with this record.
But the thing about Time Traveling that's interesting to me is the whole idea of the Soulquarian involvement with Common.
Yes.
Just for context for everybody else, this album was recorded, Like Water for Chocolate, during a basically 5-year whirlwind of recordings that happened at Electric Lady Studios here in New York City. Out of those sessions came Common's Like Water for Chocolate, Erykah Badu's Mama's Gun, and D'Angelo's Voodoo. Yep. I mean, there are other things that came out of it too. I think Firstborn Second was during those sessions as well. I think Black Star, some of this Black Star stuff got recorded during that time.
Mm-hmm.
But those three records are really the centerpiece, basically because of the same collective, the Soulquarian collective of music, musicians and singers and producers that were involved in it. I love time traveling. One thing though, I'm not a fan of like the distorted vocal on it.
I was a piano player in my last lifetime. Now I write rhymes that write minors in my light shine. Out of dark space with the world on my mind like Scarface. Boom, sex drive is like a car chase. More than a room, it's the piece of mind I chase.
Like it just seemed like he was singing through a tube or something like that. I understand the sort of effect he might have been going for, but for me, for that to be your first song on the album, that was definitely, you know, like, it took a few listens to really, like, you're like, I wonder why they decided to go with that one.
But that's what I loved about it. I feel like against the grain is everything, you know? That's
definitely against the grain, though.
Yeah, and I feel like don't always serve up the listener this predictable levels of what they're expecting. You know, I feel like when you're dealing with an artist like Common or any artist on that level of creativity, don't expect to unfold and uncover everything at one or two or three or four listens. Yeah. You know, it's like, I'm sure people who may not have felt a certain way about that intro, go back to it now, it may mean something different just because of, you know, your maturity or evolve.
Yeah, the maturity of that is really important, especially because of the fact that he's had this sort of trajectory that he is having with his albums at that point. And then this is sort of his sort of breakthrough. But I want to just dive into my intro. Now, as good as time travel and a tribute to Fela is, let's get into the first song on B, which is the B intro.
Yes. Which has a simple loop and of horns and breakbeat drum.
But here's the thing though, it's not just that. All right? That's the foundation. The foundation is the sample. You know, it's basically four bars. But the thing about it, and this shows the genius of one Mr. Kanye West, who is one of the two producers, the main producer on B, along with another stalwart of Like Water for Chocolate, Mr. Dilla. Jay Dilla.
Yeah.
So B, it starts off with that just excellent improvised bass, which is provided by none other Mr. Derek Hodge himself.
True.
And then all of a sudden you hear that doom doom doo 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 doom 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 doom, and it's just then the synthesizer comes on, which is not a part of the samples. That's the whole great thing about
who played that.
The synthesizer, I think that's Kanye on that. I'm not 100% sure. I know Derek Hodge played the bass on that.
Kanye ain't playing no synthesizer.
I know that he has played, because that was around the time he was doing Late Registration, so he didn't start playing his own synths till Graduation, so that was like 2 years later. I might have to go back to that one. But the thing is that there's a synth that was played.
James Poison.
Oh, okay. So the synth that was played on top of it to sort of mimic the sample, and then the breakbeat comes underneath the violins while the bass line is still playing and the synth is still doing its own thing. It's kind of deviating from the melody. Then all of a sudden, Calm just comes in, just spitting that heat. It's super just immediate. It's only like 2 minutes and 20 seconds, but it's just, it hits you right there. You know exactly what you're going to get from this record. And you have to also take into consideration what I just said about the trajectory coming from Like Water for Chocolate. Like Water for Chocolate is, you know, that's the first song that you hear since, I think it's One Day It All Makes Sense is the album that comes before it. This is coming off of Electric Circus, which is, I don't know how you feel about Electric Circus, but it's still an album that I at best is still taking me years to digest. At worst, it's just a mess.
Nah, for me, not to get into it because we're on something, but I would say that's the perfect example for me as when I first heard it, I didn't get it. If I hear it now, I love every minute of it.
Yeah, that's me with a lot of albums. Kendrick Lamar comes to mind. I love all his albums, but it took 5 to 6 listens before I did. But I'm still like, what? That was 2002, and it's 2019 now, and it's still sort of going over my head. But with B, that's the great thing about this intro is that it gets right to the point. Yes, time traveling is dope. There's a lot of layers to it. But there's something about the simplicity of the B intro that just gets right to the point, that really gets people to like it grabs you right away. I mean, ultimately, sometimes it's more rewarding to listen to something over and over again, and then you like it after all the listens. Mm-hmm. But it's totally different from you hear something immediately and you immediately love it.
Totally.
So, you know, that's subjective. With me, I think the immediacy of that is much, much more important. But that's just me. But
no doubt. You can't front that time traveling rhyme though. Come on.
Yeah.
I know it sounds. You're right. But the distortion throws it off.
And he was a little like he's like in attack mode or not even in attack mode on the intro.
He's an MC.
Exactly.
Yeah, totally.
I love that line. We'll talk about lyrics later. But I love that line. He says, I look into my daughter's eyes and I realize I'm gonna learn through her. The Messiah might even return through her.
Yep.
And I just love how it sets the tone for everything that you're gonna hear later with that record. With time traveling, it sort of is, but it's kind of like it follows a narrative. It's like this is a piece of what you're gonna hear, but it doesn't encapsulate the whole experience.
Agreed.
With that, let's get into the outros. It's funny because they're almost the same title.
Yeah.
So that's the outro for Like Water for Chocolate.
Well, that's the Pops joint.
Yeah.
I mean, all the Pops outros are classic.
Yeah.
Period.
Rest in peace to Lonnie Senior.
Lonnie Senior. Yeah, man, definitely classic. I love the fact that, you know, on this one particularly. This is the first time I knew of that Calm work with Kareem Riggins.
Yeah, hey, old bean.
Before this time, but I would say this put me on Kareem's radar. You know, this is a time and era where we bought the physical copies and read the liner notes happily and wanted to know who's playing this little note on this. Who's doing this? Who's saying this? Who's produced? Who's scratching? And that was something that I felt like when I saw the name Kareem Riggins, because I assumed, oh, this got to be Questlove on the drums, right?
Yeah, exactly.
You know, but when I saw the name, it kind of made me dig in. But I guess for Pop, it's hard to compare just because I feel like all of the Pop's outros were powerful in their own ways.
Yeah.
You know, and they were in different times and different realms, but they all were rooted in love and integrity and focus and, you know, just really evolving as a person and making sure that, you know, you continue to raise the bar and uplift.
Yeah.
And you could just tell from these outros, you know, it gave you a little insight on the type of relationship they had, what they might have spoken about, you know, like just regularly.
This might be the first ever push in terms of a categories, because we also go to It's Your World, Pop's Rap. This is, I think, the fourth or fifth time that Pop's gets on the track. And it's the same thing. It's super inspiring. It's so much wisdom in what he was saying.
Yeah, man.
And just shout out to Common for, you know, allowing his father to be a part of this creative process. Just throughout, I think the Dream of the Believer was the last album he did before he passed away.
Yes.
And so it's a shout out to him on that, because, you know, you hear all these horror stories or that's gotten so typical about rappers and black men that don't have their dads in their lives and things like that. It's refreshing to see that not only did Common Dad have his father around at this like pivotal time in his life when he's starting to be successful, but the fact that he's going to be a part of the process.
Absolutely.
You know, because, you know, you can have people in your life,
that
your parents in your life, your father in your life, but, you know, there are a lot of people that don't approve of you being a musician. I've heard.
Oh, yeah.
I heard the story about how Bobby Womack's dad kicked him and his brothers out of the house.
Wow.
When they said that they weren't doing gospel anymore.
Yep.
So, you know, it's crazy.
But then you also got to think, too, when it comes to Pops, what I loved also was he wasn't hesitant to share his imperfections and what wasn't right.
You
know what I'm saying? He was so unfiltered, so raw, so genuine. And it came off almost as if you're listening to a family member. You know, like it felt like family. It felt like, oh, man, this is something my uncle would say and sound just like that. Or, you know, someone in the fam. So I definitely commend him on it. I can't really debate too hard against that It's Your World version.
Yeah.
That beat is everything.
Yeah, Dilla killed that.
That beat is everything, man.
I love the fact that they put, I'll just talk about this real briefly before we go to the next category. I love the fact that Kanye is basically informing the whole album in terms of production, with Dilla contributing to a smaller degree, but the fact that Dilla basically takes the anchor of the relay and takes it all the way home. You know what I'm saying?
Yes.
That speaks to an unspoken humility that Kanye has for his mentors and for the people that came before him that, you know, we don't talk about too much. So now let's get into category number two, Higher Highs. And we're going to talk about the single releases of this album. I'll go first. The single releases for B were The Food, The Corner, Go, Testify, and Faithful. Now, that's pretty extreme to have five singles on an album that has 11 songs. But then again, I don't really mind. I mean, Michael Jackson's my favorite artist of all time, and he whored out his albums all the time. You know, Thriller had seven singles out of nine songs or whatever it was.
And that was the formula back then.
Oh, yeah, definitely. Yeah. It's so different now where, like stuff leaks. I mean, I think on Black America, again, I heard seven songs before the album was even out.
Oh, wow.
So I felt like I had already listened to Khan's album by the time it was out. I was like, well, I need to get it for you. Already gave me everything.
Yeah.
But the cool thing about these singles is The Food. The first time I heard The Food was actually a couple of years before the album was even released.
Dave Chappelle?
Yes, indeed.
Yeah, I remember that.
That's the first time Kanye ever rapped in front of an audience, also in terms of like on television.
Yeah.
And it was a great introduction to what we were to expect in terms of just the sonics of the sampling, the grittiness of the lyrics, just the whole idea of having, you know, to hustle and do wrong things to get to do things for your family, which is, you know, such a, like I said, it's one of those things that's cliched, but it can't be cliched when it's the truth, you know what I'm saying? And so for Khan to express those ideas, a great same thing, which leads right into The Corner, which is maybe my favorite song on the whole album. Great, great video featuring The Last Poets.
Yes, respect to The Last Poets.
Yes, indeed. I see, this is why I love Kanye and Common together. I mean, Common and Dilla together are great, and a bunch of other producers, of course, Common and No ID. But there's just something about what Kanye brings to the table in terms of just authenticity of production, in terms of trying to find somebody's ultimate potential in terms of the backdrop. And for a song like The Corner, when you have people like The Last Poets giving this spoken word eloquence to, you know, that lyric, we write songs about wrong because it's hard to see right. I just love what they bring to them.
The Corner was our magic, our music, our politics. Fires raised as tribal dances and war cries broke out on different corners. Power to the people, black power, black is beautiful.
Go, I know what Go was for. Of course, that's the single. That had first single written all over it. Kudos to them for not making it the first single, by the way.
Yeah.
But, and then, of course, Testify. An excellent use of, what's that song? Guilty Until Proven Innocent by The Honeycomb.
Mm-hmm.
Definitely a dope, dope sample. And then, of course, Faithful, which features a then relatively unknown or burgeoning star, John Legend, who was also all over B in certain respects. Just a great lineup of songs, all very cohesive in a certain respect too. Talk about Like Water for Chocolate singles, because this is I find this very interesting.
Yeah, I was gonna say they should have made They Say a single.
You know what? I take that back. The Corner is my second favorite song. Yeah, They Say is my first.
They Say, man. Jeez.
Yeah, that was, jeez. In hindsight, it was.
Kanye, you get that all day.
Yeah, man.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The single, so Sixth Sense,
yeah.
For me, just nerding out, you know, this is off of hearing Bilal, you know, for the first time on his album. Mm-hmm. But then also hearing Common, Bilal, and Primo together on a track, I felt like for the raw hip-hop audience, that was groundbreaking. Just yeah. because we never really heard Calm on Premiere. We never heard Calm on that type of
like a hardcore East Coast
exactly.
sort of thing.
Yeah. And it's like we heard Calm on beats similar, but not Premiere. You know
yeah,
what I'm
definitely.
Saying? It was just basically straight out of the, you know, hardcore boom bap 90s archive. And it was refreshing, especially when you throw Bilal on there just to kind of widen it to get more ears and eyes on it. The Light, to me, The Light still to this day is one of Common's more popular songs and most yeah. notable songs, you know. You know, not just because it won the Grammy, but because, I mean, they sampled an amazing record, number one.
Yeah. Shout out to Bobby Caldwell.
Exactly.
By the way, if you're listening to this, Bobby Caldwell is a white man. I know there are some of you that still don't know. So, yeah, this is your There's No Santa Claus moment. Bobby yeah. Caldwell, the guy that did Open Our Eyes, My Flame, yeah. and What You Don't Do for Love. He's a white dude.
Yeah.
Okay.
And, you know, it's funny. It's like, I'm glad you said that, because that was one of the artists that you hear as a kid, you're jamming, and in your mind, this is definitely a brown person singing. And then you find out when you're an adult, like, oh, wow.
Michael okay. McDonald's another guy like that.
Michael McDonald. But, yeah, I felt like The Light, you know, that's one of the songs that you can go anywhere and say, yo, Common, The Light. You never heard that before? And you start singing, oh, yeah, I love it.
Yeah.
You know, so I like the fact that he was able to get one of those records that are just classic, notable. You could play it in a room where people are not even necessarily in tune with hip-hop, but they may still recognize that song and that record. And I love that him and Dilla kept it authentic and genuine and did what they would do anyway
mm-hmm.
and won a Grammy for it.
It's one of the cleanest Dilla beats I've ever heard.
Oh, totally.
It's just a pristine in terms of its sonics. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. You don't hear any crackles, any hiss. It's just so clean. But it's funny how there are more singles on B with less songs on the track list, but there are way more songs on Like Water for Chocolate with less singles.
Less singles, exactly. And I would admit to this, mm-hmm. had I been choosing the singles for Like Water for Chocolate, I don't think I would have chosen Sixth Sense to be a single.
Yeah, and I'll talk about that.
And I definitely would not have chosen Ghetto Heaven to be a single.
Yeah.
I mean, I get why they chose that, the latter, Ghetto Heaven, you know, Macy Gray. I'm trying to remember, wasn't there a different version?
Yeah,
the
it was a remix.
It was a remix,
It was a remix
right?
that was...
For the video,
For
right?
the video.
Yeah, yeah. But, I mean, even with that, I felt like production-wise, I definitely gravitated to Ghetto Heaven right away, just because, you know, that's just one of those classic tunes that mm-hmm. you heard back in the day. But I would say in the singles category, I would easily say, yeah, I feel like B won that battle, just because
yeah.
when I think about the album, I mean, even something like, I would have chose Nag Champa. That's one of my favorite songs.
That's a great, like I said, that's for nerds like that. I think Thelonious would have been a dope single.
Totally, totally.
But yeah, probably not, and I'll get into this in a moment. So I think this is a perfect lead into the next one, the most contentious category, Lower Lows. All right, so we're supposed to pick the weakest song on each other's album and just basically say, okay, there's nothing on our album that's this week. So for you, what's the song that's on B that you would...
It's not that easy.
It's not easy for either of these.
Well, B is harder because it's not that many songs.
Yeah, it's only 11 tracks.
I would say Shy City is the weakest song for me on B.
Yo, Go is right there for you to take.
I love Go. I love Go. To me, like Go, like you said, it is the cliche first single.
Yeah.
I love the fact they didn't do it first, but I also love the fact that this is an attempt. I feel like too many MCs, men, forget about the women. And they forget, like, yo, you don't have to do a song about women, particularly to get women into it, like sonically. And I felt like that song to me is a song that when the women hear it specifically, yo, they ready to get down. They vibing. They love it.
So what is it about Shy City that you would take it off of this?
For me, I just feel like it's a pretty straightforward, cliche hip-hop joint, you know? The scratches, it's even the delivery. It's just, I feel like if you took Shy City off this record, it doesn't kill the album.
Mm-hmm. Okay, I'm about to say something real controversial.
Oh, man.
All right, so Lowest Low. All right, so Like Water for Chocolate. And just for the record, and I say this in every episode,
we do not
hate each other's albums. That's what makes this so dope.
Oh yeah, I'll say this on record too. Common is one of my favorite artists.
Yeah,
period.
Me too.
Like, yeah.
Now here's the thing, I was leaning toward a film called Pimp.
What?
Originally.
Come on.
But after further examining, after further examination, I'm gonna say this is gonna be real crazy. I'm gonna say The Sixth Sense.
Yes. You know.
Let me tell you why. For the most part, the whole album, and I'll get into this even later when we talk about the last, when we close things out. Everything is produced by the Soulquarian crew. Or at least someone from there. You have, you got D'Angelo, you got Dilla, you got Questlove, you got Roy Hargrove, you got James Poison.
Mm-hmm.
Therefore, you know, Sixth Sense sticks out like a sore thumb because you immediately know that it's Primo.
Yeah.
That it's a DJ Premier produced track. And especially coming right after the time traveling reprise, where it's reminding you of this journey that you've been on all this time. And then all of a sudden, just out of nowhere, The Sixth Sense just comes on. It was like, it's a shock to the system. It's a great song, but it just for the cohesion of the album, it just, to me, it didn't fit.
I agree. Sonically, it's definitely different. And it's not married to the others. And you're right, because of that reason, that Soulquarian musicality, a lot of the others are led with live music.
Yeah, and that's another thing. A lot of the elements of live musicianship that just aren't on, that just aren't there. But, you know.
So it's like, I mean, honestly, it's like a similar trade-off. I took Shy City away because, not that I felt like sonically it doesn't work, I felt like it's the most regular, straightforward,
it just, it's like you said, if it wasn't there, you wouldn't miss it.
Yeah.
All right, so we're going to talk about the lyrics on the album real quick. This is going to be a little interesting. So just throw out some of the reasons lyrically why Like
Song
Water for Chocolate.
Asada. Oh, my God. And, you know, some people may say it's nerding out. Mm-hmm. You listen to that track, you now recognize and understand the storytelling ability of the brother Rashid, Lonnie Lynn Smith.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, it's just, you just understand that Common is beyond just a style rapper or a spitter in a sense of braggadocio.
Mm-hmm.
But he tells this story in such an amazing way that it not only uplifts Asada, it gives you a history lesson. It points to the injustices that happen, you know, to our people around the world, but here in this country particularly. And I just felt like he nailed it.
There were lights and sirens, gunshots firing. Cover your eyes as I describe a scene so violent. Seemed like a bad dream. She laid in the blood puddle, blood bubbled in her chest. Cold air brushed against open flesh. No room to rest. Pain consumed these breaths. Shot twice with her hands up. Police questioned, but shot before she answered. One panther.
You can listen to that song and not know a thing about what happened and totally get the whole story, but it's done in such a cool way. You know, it's not boring, it's not preachy, it's dope, man. And then I love the CeeLo Calm Connect, man. I felt like CeeLo Green really pulled the emotion out of that song, man. Yeah.
CeeLo's feature game was dope around this time because.
Oh, yeah.
Was on my favorite song on Aquemini, the Liberation joint that he was out with Erica for Outkast. And so his feature game was definitely on the come up around that time. Yeah. But
of course, Nag Champa too. That's one of my favorites on the record. I felt like lyrically, it was just so. What's the word I'm looking for? I just felt like so introspective, but also just, I mean, it laid in the beat. And then you're hearing Dilla singing on the vocals. It made you feel like Dilla could have did a whole singing album low-key. And
he probably would have if he lived long enough.
Absolutely, you know? But that, you know, I feel when it comes to Common, I feel like he's not giving enough credit to for being one of the top MCs. Period.
No, absolutely not. Yeah. If in terms of like in the natural overall zeitgeist or whatever the conversation when it comes to like top five, I seldom hear him brought up. You know what I'm saying?
Agree.
I mean, granted, he's not in mine, but he's definitely in my top five in terms of the most underrated.
Yeah.
Like him and Busta Rhymes may be the most underrated MCs. Like even though he's, like I said, he's got a Grammy, he's got an Emmy, he's got an Oscar. I still think in terms of just being an MC.
What's he missing, a Tony?
He's missing a Tony. Robert Glasper is going to try to get him a Tony.
Nice.
Because nice. They're working out a play right now.
Yeah, and I just feel that Calm, you know, it's one of those things where I don't think he's underrated per se, because I feel like when people hear him, they love it.
Yeah.
I think it's more of the time he came in.
Mm-hmm.
And then I don't know why this happens, but for whatever reason, when that top five is brought up, most people feel like you can only choose from the golden era.
Basically.
You know? And it's like,
and plus he came up around a time where hip hop became super commercial in that mid 90s.
Absolutely.
That second golden age.
Absolutely.
You have Biggie and Nas and Jay-Z really doing their thing and just sort of separating themselves in terms of commercial success that Calm never really got to. You know what I'm saying?
Exactly.
Like, he got respected critically, he got his awards, he has his fan base, but in terms of, it's kind of like that line in Moment of Clarity by Jay-Z, where he's like, I wanted to rap like Common Sense, but then I did 5 mil. I ain't rapped like Common Sense.
Absolutely. Yeah.
I want to get into some of these lyrics with B, man. Now, I love lyrically, I want to start with Faithful.
Mm-hmm.
I just love how he breaks down the verses from being, you know, being faithful about your woman, but preceding it with being faithful to God. And like your actual religious and spiritual faith. Mm-hmm. And even tying them together, when he says,
I was rolling around in my mind, it occurred. What if God was a her? Would I treat her the same? Would I still be running game on her? In what type of ways would I want her? Would I want her for a mind or a heavenly body? Could be out here bogus with someone so godly. If I was with her, would I still be wanting my ex? The lies, the greed, the weed, the sex.
It's kind of like I used to love her. When he's using a woman as the embodiment of hip-hop, he's using the same thing, like the embodiment of God, in terms of being faithful, in terms of like the way I'm living my life. Like, a lot of people claim to be faithful to God and spiritual and devout, but, you know, at the same time, would I be like, well, you know, I believe in God, but I'm going to do what I want, and I'll make up for it later. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
I just love that, how he started off with that and then went into the whole idea about being faithful to your partner. I just,
absolutely.
And you talk about storytelling on the song for Asada. The storytelling on Testify.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yo.
Yeah.
As we say, as M. Night Shyamalan would say, what a twist.
Yes. Also, I mean, you know, kudos for, who was that, Taraji P. Henson?
Yes, Taraji is in the video. And, and brother from the Tyler Perry flick was her husband.
Yes.
Great performance in that. But just the whole, how he set it up with the guy in the courtroom, the backstory of the guy, and then he's guilty in the turn. And then when you find out that it was her, just from the way she walked out of the courtroom, and it's just like, it's so vivid. You don't even need to have a video for that. That was the dope thing. And like I said, and just going back, and then you mentioned They Say. We have to talk about They Say real quick.
They Say. Yeah, man.
I just love, I got to give it up to my man Kanye West. You know, for better or worse, I can't go deep into it because I'll probably jeopardize a lot of my, you know, gigs if I go too much love on Kanye right now because it's so fashionable to hate him. But his verse on They Say, I just love...
look how they did D'Angelo. Yeah. Ask him, how does it feel?
I just love how. I love that. I just.
Yeah, Kanye snapped on this verse.
On this verse, I want to talk. Super I want to talk about this one particular set of bars.
My best friends worry about me, because they know when you famous and you have made cash, the media aims at us and you be up so high. If you ever fall off, it feel like a plane crash.
But God don't ever
give me nothing I can't handle, so please don't ever give me records I can't sell. Yo, he killed that.
He killed it.
But it's also, but the crazy thing is, it was almost like it was a self-fulfilling prophecy.
Oh, yeah.
You know, it's like Anakin Skywalker when he has a dream about his mom and dream about his wife, and he tries to do what he can to make it not happen. By doing that, he makes it happen anyway.
Yeah.
So that, just the double of that, it just rocked my world.
It's safe to say, I might be jumping out the window, but I feel like it's safe to say he out-rhymed Calm on this one.
You know what? I got to get, you know what? Yeah.
Yeah.
I got to.
You know, and I love Calm's verse too.
But
you know,
but you know what it is? Common has one of the most, I think him and DMX have the most unconventional flows in hip-hop history. I was going to say Chuck D, but Chuck D is void of flow, so I can't really say it's unconventional. Shout out to Chuck D. I love Chuck D.
No doubt.
But, yeah, his lack of flow keeps him out of my top five. But Common's approach to flowing is so unorthodox.
Yeah.
And Kanye, the way he did this, like you said with the whole thing, Goopy Love Now, gotta be them wheels, Kate's exactly. back down, now to be that steel, you know.
Yeah.
Just the way he approached those sort of things and those little vocal flourishes, because the vocals, like he uses vocals as an instrument on all his projects. So just the way he approached it made it that much more enjoyable and that much more memorable. But just, yeah, I think he, and same thing like on No More Parties with L.A., he out-rapped Kendrick, you know?
Oh, yeah.
So, you know, he has.
He out-rapped Nas on The Cop Shot the Kid, too.
Yeah, he did.
He did.
But it's because of that flow again.
Exactly.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Cops gonna came that it was self-defense. You know, like Nas was basically rapping like he was doing the TED Talk.
Exactly.
That's what I said about, because that's what I said about Jay-Z 444. It was a TED Talk set to beats. You know what I'm saying? That's what Nas did on a lot of the Nas Air album. And then Kanye's, the way he approached it, it just made you remember it more. So it's time to take this thing home. Let's get to the X Factor. I'll give it to you, JR. What is the X Factor? What is that one underlying thing that makes Like Water for Chocolate special?
J Dilla. That's the X Factor. And the reason I say that, personally, I feel like J Dilla, and I'm sure Common would agree, is one of the reasons that Calm continued to do the type of music he did. You know, I felt like J Dilla showed him something else, gave him a different palette to choose and pick from and rock with. And then even I felt like ushered in Common thinking of these projects less and less like boom bap hip hop and more like, let me create what I'm feeling and let me bring to the table like the real emotions and things. And let me not just make an album just because of rap music. Let me make an album because of life. You know what I'm saying? And I felt like that's what Water for Chocolate did for me. It just, the musicality of it, but Common and Dilla working together, I felt like it was an awakening, you know, for both of them really. But definitely for Common, I felt like that took his career to those next notches and just put him in that space. Even though I do agree he never got that superstardom, that album started to put him in that space of like, oh wow, okay,
yeah,
Common,
definitely this is definitely his, what we call his breakthrough album. I mean, a lot of people talk about Resurrection, and it's a great album, you know, probably a classic, but this is what made people stop and take notice that ordinarily wouldn't even listen to rap, let alone listen to Common.
Agreed.
And the thing about Dilla that's so great is, it's like you said, I think Dilla would have been Dilla without Common, but I think that he definitely saw Common as somebody to, you know, be different with,
yeah,
in
man.
Terms of
yeah.
his music making. And then Common, I think, you know, raised his game more differently, I guess you could say. His approach to beats was different on Dilla than on anybody else. It was just
totally agreed.
Yeah, yeah. Even when you think about stuff like that's on The Shining and you know, stuff like that, or the, yeah. the one-off stuff they did, like The Movement, and, you know, all those records. You know, it's great. But that actually leads me to my X factor about B. I feel like Common, these two albums aren't, they're not typical hip hop albums. They're more like they're black musician albums.
What?
You know what I'm saying? For back, lack of a better term. I think that Like Water for Chocolate could have been basically a sort of groove, Afrobeat laden sort of inspired record. But I think because of the fact that you have, I think just from a production standpoint, it's a great album, but it's not as cohesive as B because of the fact that it's top heavy with Soquarian mm-hmm. live instrumentation for the first 6 out of 7 songs.
Yeah.
And then you get this really quick thing with, you know, then you have The Light and The Sixth Sense and all this other stuff. Mm-hmm. Then it's just him and Dilla alone.
Mm-hmm.
And then just sort of peppered in with Soulquarians here and there. And then, you, like I said, you have the premiere joint in the middle. With B, like I said, if Like Water for Chocolate is like basically an Afrobeat funk album,
yeah.
then B is a Chicago soul record. You know what I'm saying? When you think about people like Dianne Hathaway, people like Earth, Wind & Fire, you know, people from Chess Records and things like that, all that, it's sort of like a cousin to like the Philadelphia soul,
absolutely.
R&B that was happening.
Yep.
But the Chicago soul has its definite sound of like the 60s and 70s. I think that Kanye, being also being from Chicago, recognized that and saw this as an opportunity to make their stamp to be, this is a Chicago hip-hop record. But it's not necessarily hip hop because it sounds the way Kanye was sampling music back then, the soulful samples, is kind of evolving away from the whole Chipmunk thing, because this is also the same around the same time he's doing Late Registration.
Yes.
And he's getting more into the orchestral idea of it. That's why the B intro with the violin loop is so great. And then you get the sort of the choral, the sped up choral sample on The Corner. And then you have like Dilla's when he's the God is Love sample with Dilla, you know, with
yes.
the sort of ethereal Marvin Gaye vocals in the back. Yeah, it's such a cohesive record because, like I said, 9 out of the 11 songs are Kanye. And then Dilla is sort of like in the middle and at the end. But because Kanye was inspired by Dilla and because Dilla was basically shoulder to shoulder with Kanye during the recording process, it made it so that they were kind of interchangeable. Like, you couldn't tell where a Kanye beat, to a small sense, you couldn't tell where a Kanye beat stopped and a Dilla beat began. Of course, if you isolated them, of course, you could tell the difference between the two. But in the listening process from beginning to end, it, you know, you can say that, man, it flows from one to the next to the next to the next.
Yeah, man.
And that's the thing I love about B. It's a Chicago record, unapologetically and purposefully so. And that's what I really liked about it. You know what I'm saying? And Kanye, at that point, having the opportunity to produce an entire album for this one artist,
mm-hmm.
A fellow Chicagoan, who was at that time coming off of a hiccup. And then to show the world, no, like, don't write this guy out. This guy is great. And without having to really assert his own greatness, we all know how Kanye gasses himself up, but
yeah,
he let Common take center stage on this record. You know, today we have all these albums where we have one producer on the album, then the producer has to get billing with the artist.
Mm-hmm.
Like, you have this person and Metro Boomin. You have this person and DJ Mustard and
yeah,
all that stuff.
Yeah.
Kanye was never really about that.
Yeah.
You know, and that's what I loved about that. And the same thing with the Soulquarians. But I think the thing about Like Water for Chocolate, I think that it's almost like those records would have gotten made if Common wasn't there or not.
Mm.
Just because of the fact that it was all happening in the same studio over mm-hmm. the same period.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, hell, I mean, Chicken Grease was supposed to be on Like Water for Chocolate, and D'Angelo basically kept it.
Yeah.
Because him and...
It sounds like doing it, almost.
Yeah, it does.
It's in that vein.
Definitely. And doing it, also, another shout out to Dilla, an excellent use of Give It To Me Baby bass line. Super dope way he flipped that. Just go off. Yeah. But I think, like I said, it was kind of going back and forth between the Soulquarian and Just Dilla sort of dichotomy, where there's B felt like it was Dilla and Kanye together, even though it was the opposite.
Yeah, it's definitely way more of a nerd record to me. Like, you got to nerd out on like Water for Chocolate. You can on B too, but like Water for Chocolate,
B is a more accessible record to the hip hop fan.
Yes.
I think for people like you and I, who are very esoteric and at the same time very eclectic in our tastes in music in general, but black music in particular, that record's always going to stand out. But I think B is more for hip hop heads, pure hip hop heads.
Agreed.
Thanks, everybody, for joining us for episode 4 of Get Off the Fence, Common, Like Water for Chocolate versus B. Thank you so much to J.R. Robinson for being an excellent, excellent guest this week. And this archival episode, which was back from March of 2019. Next week, our Quincy Jones episode will be the last of our archival episodes before we get into the 3 brand new episodes recorded back in 2020. So please join us next Monday, and please don't forget to subscribe. We are available on RSS, on Spotify, we are available on Apple Music, and we are available on YouTube and Google Podcasts. See you guys next week. Crap games, black dames and big faces, cases in court. Fam showing love and support. You and your baby's mom thought the love was a...